This is Jordan Poyer, safety for the Buffalo Bills, and you are now listening to Cover One Buffalo Podcast. Let's go.
Good evening and welcome to this special edition of the Cover One Buffalo Podcast. Getting excited to be able to talk a little bit about our team when we have a moment here to take a break. It's kind of crazy to be able to think about the fact that our Buffalo Bills are actually 9-3 and coming off a dominant, exciting win on Thanksgiving in Dallas, 26-15. And now we're putting us in a position where we can actually take a minute to be able to look forward. So with a little bit of a long break here and no game to break down tomorrow night, I thought we'd do a little bit of work to take a look at what else is out there and what other things we may want to be able to look into besides just what we've had so far week to week. And I know that's a dangerous thing and something that we haven't had a great opportunity to do as Bills fans, to be honest. And I thought this was a good opportunity to kind of take stock and where we're at. So we're going to go through a couple different things tonight. We're going to take a quick look at some projections of the rest of the regular season. We're going to take a look at some potential scenarios, playoff seedings, some things that I think could potentially impact where the Bills align as the end of the season goes, and talk about a couple different things that I think some folks want to hear about as far as the division, seeding in the playoffs, how those things work. And then maybe look a little bit beyond that into some of the things in the offseason. I hear a lot of people talking about, oh, this guy should be cut, or we need to re-sign this guy now. I'm going to talk through a couple of those things as well. So first, I'm going to go through a couple of the different tools that I'm using here tonight. One, I'm using the NFL playoff machine. There's a couple good ones out there. New York Times has one, 538 has one, ESPN has one. So there's a couple different ones where you can go and pick basically the result of every game the rest of the season and be able to show where things are going to shake out. So I went through, projected every game the rest of the season. For the sake of this exercise, I was trying to be pretty realistic and baseline. And the reason that I'm going to say that I'm going to project that the Bills finish 2-2 the rest of the way here is multiple things. I think one, it's the safest projection. I think that's what Vegas is going to have projected with the Bills being a favorite against Pittsburgh. Even in Pittsburgh, I think they'll be a slight favorite. I think they'll be a favorite at home against the Jets. They're already roughly a touchdown underdog at home against Baltimore, depending on how that game goes with San Francisco tomorrow, which will obviously be a big game. And then they'll obviously be an underdog in New England. From an emotional standpoint, obviously I would love to upset Baltimore or upset New England. I think it would be great strategically because both teams currently have a 1.5 to 2 game lead on the Bills. I don't know that there's a great scenario for it to impact where the Bills get to in the regular season. So emotionally, I wouldn't mind the idea of a tough fought, hard nosed, you know, late emotional loss to both teams that we have a chance to avenge here in the playoffs and be able to go back and get them when the games actually matter. So obviously I'd love for the Bills to run the table, be able to go 4-0 the rest of the way, finish at 13-3. Even if they finish 13-3, it's actually fairly realistic that they wouldn't win the division. And I'll go through that in a moment here. But for the sake of this exercise, I'm going to project that the Bills finish 2-2, end up going 11-5, that they beat both Pittsburgh and the Jets, and that they lose tough ones to the Ravens and the Pats. Again, I think they showed Thursday against Dallas that they can beat any team, they can hang in any game, and that I do think there's a chance that we could pull off, but just for the sake of this, we'll say the team goes 2-2. The things that we need to look at here are that the playoff seedings break down in the NFL. I know a lot of teams, you end up looking at a couple different things of what is, common opponent, what is, divisional record, what's conference record. And there's a couple different things that people look at that get a little bit confused. There are two sets of actual tiebreakers in the NFL. One is for conference tiebreakers, which would be how we'd break a tie if we're going for a wild card against, say, Houston or Oakland or a team like that. There's actually a different set of divisional tiebreakers that when we're trying to figure out if we could win the division against the AFC East, obvious dominant team, the Patriots. I don't fault a lot of Bills fans for not knowing the divisional tiebreakers, because they haven't mattered in about 20 years. So just a couple of things to look at. Both of them start out with head-to-head. That's pretty, you know, normal. In the division, the win-loss record within the division is the next tiebreaker. So say the Bills were to upset the Patriots, and then we beat, you know, we sweep the Jets and sweep the Dolphins. They sweep the Jets and sweep the Dolphins, but we both go 1-1. We're both 5-1. That's thrown out. The challenging part, and that where most people get some of their tiebreakers wrong, is that the conference tiebreaker next goes to best record in the conference. So people are looking at that saying, hey, you know, they lost to the Ravens, our loss is to the Eagles, and had some other things there. We can make up for that. In the division race, it's actually common opponents. So the challenge with catching the Patriots for the division is that they beat the Browns and they beat the Eagles. So we would need to be able to beat the Patriots and beat the Ravens and have the Patriots lose to either the Bengals or the Dolphins. And it's just, obviously, those are incredibly unlikely things to occur. So it's not out of the question. There is a scenario where the Bills can run the table, go 13-3. The Patriots either lose, go 2-3 and lose three games to end up falling to 12-4, or lose to the Bengals or the Dolphins along with the Bills, and then we're both tied at 13-3 and win the division. For obviously the reasons I just went through, you can tell that that's not the most likely scenario. So for that reason, and for what many fans are going to understand, we are very heavily locked into this fifth seed. So I'm going to spend a fair amount of time talking about what does that mean and who we might face here. Right now, it's looking the most likely that we will face the winner of the AFC South. So with three teams all very, very close, Houston at 7-4, Indy at 6-5, Tennessee at 6-5. Kansas City's also at 7-4. They play the Raiders. I think there's a possibility you could see a little bit of shenanigans there. So if you're rooting for Kansas City to get knocked out, which I could understand with their high-flying offense, you would want to root for the Raiders to win and then the Chiefs to go on a free fall for them to get knocked out of that area. It's a chance we could play the Raiders. I think Kansas City's talented enough. Mahomes looks healthy. They're going to stick where they are. I'm going to project that they end up at the third seed with roughly an 11-5 record. I'm projecting them to finish 4-1. When you're looking at the AFC South, that leaves us with figuring out where do things fall between Indy, Houston, and Tennessee. Indy has the best schedule the rest of the way. Houston and Tennessee both play a couple tougher opponents. So when looking at it, I think all of them are looking at somewhere in the 2-3, 3-2 range down the stretch. I think Indy has the best shot to go 4-1. With some of their easier games that they have going here. And, you know, you're talking about they do play Tennessee, but then they also play Tampa Bay. They also play a game against Carolina, who's a little bit out of it. They play the Jags. So the Saints is probably their toughest game the rest of the way. I think I projected them to lose to the Saints and then win those other games. But they play each other. They could all knock each other off. It's very likely the Bills are going to be coming in 11-5, playing a 9-7 or even an 8-8 division-winning team. And then you'll be on the road either way. We were talking about it in the Cover One Premium Slack channel quite a bit that I think there's reason to want to play or not want to play each of the teams. If I'm ranking it, I'm going to do it either by quarterback or overall talent. I think I'd rather play the Colts the most out of any of the teams. I think Tennessee has the best defense. I think Houston is the best quarterback. So if I'm going to be kind of throwing it out there, I'd rather play Indy, and that I think we can beat all three teams. I think we have a chance to do that. But if I'm going to pick and choose, I'll avoid Deshaun Watson if I can. So hopefully that's the way it shakes out. We'll kind of see how those things go and where we end up looking at it. But right now, that's what I'm projecting. I think that the most likely scenario, and if you look at some of the different playoff odds, predictors and things like that, this is where it would shake out. Oddly, I didn't do this on purpose, but the way that I projected the rest of the games, the Cleveland Browns end up snagging the sixth seed because of finishing strong in their last stretch here and being able to finish out on a winning note. And they have some very easy winnable games. the rest of the way. So I think that'd be kind of funny if that happened that way. But I think that either the Raiders, the Browns, or the Texans are going to be fighting for that sixth seed. I think you're going to see that going back and forth with the teams that are there. I think that if they go that way, the way that the divisional round is, if the Chiefs end up with a third seed and win, they automatically would go to the two seed. I have that as Baltimore. So we'd be looking at playing the Colts in Indy, if we win there, going on to play the Patriots in New England. I think that would be awesome if we have another hard-fought game. If we end up having a battle there, you know the sayings about how hard it is to be able to beat a team twice or beat a team three times. You know, so if we're going into that third game, I think there's a chance that we could look at kind of going that route and having a tough game there. Hopefully, we have a great game with Baltimore next week and give us a path there. So, you know, I don't want to go nuts and say that I think we're going to go on some Super Bowl run or things like that, but it's exciting to be able to actually talk about how playoff seeding may matter. We another topic we were just talking about in the premium Slack channel was the fact that there's very likely week 17 may not matter. We haven't had that in a long time for the Bills. There's a chance that if the Bills win and get a 10th win, which I think is very reasonable to happen, at least against Pittsburgh, is that we may lock up the wild card spot right there, getting a 10th win. I don't think there's any other team that's going to get to a 10th win in the teams that are battling for it now. I think that they'd be able to lock that up, and then the Patriots game and the Jets game might not have all that much bearing. I'm curious to see how someone like McDermott will approach that. I think that they'll go week by week, try to win every game, play everybody there. You could maybe see some guys get pulled in the second half of the Jets game, but I think they would approach it going in there. Greg Kishmanian in the chat was asking, is there a scenario where we clinch next week? In every predictor that I've looked at, if we get to 10 wins, it's 99 or 99.9% that we make it. So I don't know that in that early that technically in week 13, we would officially clinch it. But for all intents and purposes, we would basically clinch it and have that spot locked up. I would bet it wouldn't be official until a few other teams lose in week 14 or even in week 15 that it's there. If we were somehow to beat Baltimore and Pittsburgh and then obviously get to 11-3 at that stage, it would be officially locked up and clinched. But again, I don't think there's a scenario that even beating Baltimore, it would be officially clinched in the moment. But in reality, in all intents and purposes, it would be clinched from that standpoint. So again, I don't think that's anything crazy to look at the schedule the rest of the way, the predictors and what are out there. Right now, most of them are showing it's very likely that Baltimore and New England are going to end up as the top two seeds. They're in good position to do that. The Bills can make some noise. They play both of those teams. They have a chance to do that. There is a not impossible scenario where the Bills go on a run here and they're able to close out getting one of those first round buys. I think that that would be pretty crazy and would be a very unlikely scenario, but it is possible. But it's still crazy that we're actually talking about that here after Thanksgiving game of things that are now in the realm of possibility that we didn't even really dream about before. So kind of taking a look at it, seeing some of the other areas here. Jeffrey was asking, what's the tiebreaker with New England if we do tie? Again, it's kind of broken down between the order of the things that happen. It would have to take, in order for us to do it, it goes head-to-head, best record within the division, best record amongst common opponents, and then best record in the conference. So for in order for us to do that, because the common game, because they already beat the Browns, because they already beat the Eagles, they need a loss to the Dolphins, which would be kind of tough to project. So again, it's going to take something pretty crazy and some weird upsets for the Bills to win a tiebreaker with the Patriots. So I just don't think it's realistic, even though it's technically possible. One of the other things I took some time preparing here today was looking even beyond that, because I know that, you know, we're going to watch the games shake out the way that they are. We're going to enjoy them and go through there. But some of the things that are coming up here are some of the talent that we're seeing really break out and some things that are out there as far as who the possible people we should be looking to lock up to further extensions, looking at contract work, looking at who could be cut, looking at who we want to re-sign, who's a free agent, and who wants to come up as an extension beyond that. So I'm going to get into some financial talk here and some of the things that we're going to go through. Is going to be a lot of numbers, so I'll try to be careful not to ramble too much into the minutiae of things. Right now, by benefit of the Bills having one of the healthiest rosters in the NFL, we actually have a pretty good amount of cap space. A lot of the things that people spend, the teams spend the most money in season on, is guys that go on the IR, and then you have to sign somebody else off the street onto the roster, and you have to pay them. So you pay the guy that goes on injured reserve, and you pay the new guy, and it basically is not quite $1 million a hit, but it's usually somewhere between $600,000 to $1 million for each player, and you tack that on each time that it goes. So right now, the Bills have $26.6 million in cap space. I'm going to project that they use up about $2 million of that, that we have about three more players that we end up having to sign during the year. I think that's pretty normal, or even on the high end out of the last three games. That goes to $90.9 million. I'm going to project that at $88.9 million, roughly $89 million in available funds. One of the first things that comes up, we'll start on the guys who we could get rid of, is, hey, we need to cut, and they start rattling off names. So I'm going to go through a few of them that I think, one, Brandon Bean already put us in an outstanding position that we don't need to cut anyone. We don't have anyone that we have to cut. We had guys in the past, like when we had the Marcel Darius contract, when we had some things like that, that were a total albatross, and we absolutely had to be able to cut them to even function. We don't have to do that anymore. We took that dead cap medicine. We ate $55 million in 1 year, and came out and then basically used all that money to sign the huge cachet of 18 unrestricted free agents we had this past year. So coming into this year, one, we don't have to cut anyone. But here's the names that get thrown out there a lot. One, the most common, is Star Lotulelei. Star is not going to get cut because there's no benefit. So if we were to cut him next year, you eat $7.8 million in dead cap and only save $2.3 million. So if you cut Star, you'd still have to go out and sign a rotational defensive tackle. Signing a rotational defensive tackle will cost you roughly $2 million. And Star is at least good enough to be on a roster and to get snaps and to be able to rotate in. So I think that there's no benefit to do that. I will say, after the 2020 season, going into 2021, it flips. It's only $2.3 million in dead cap and $7.8 million in cap savings. At that point, if he's not having a strong season, you could see that. But for anybody who's looking forward to Star Lotulelei being gone, I got bad news. He's going to be on this roster in 2020. The two names that I think are possible where the cap savings number is significant enough where their performance has not met up to that are both Trent Murphy and Tyler Kroft. Trent Murphy is $1.75 million in dead cap with $7.2 million in savings. That's a big number as of right now without a really strong finish. I think that's a very reasonable possibility going into next year. Tyler Kroft is very injury laden. The reason that he hasn't led up to that, but he's $1.6 million in dead cap and $5 million in cap savings. So cutting both Trent Murphy and Tyler Kroft, we would eat $3.3 million in dead cap, but we would save $12 million. $12 million is an extension for a really good player I'll talk about in just a minute, or a really high-end free agent coming in. I think that there's a higher scenario that Tyler Kroft ends up earning that the rest of this way in the final four games and a playoff run where he could show that when he's healthy, he can contribute. But again, we don't have to cut either of them, but both of them have a big enough number that I think that is going to be very tantalizing. There's three more names that get thrown out a fair amount that just don't have the financial impact to matter, but are possible. Lee Smith, you could cut with $1 million in dead cap and save $2.25 million. Steven Hauschka, you'd have $1.25 million and you'd save $1.8 million. Patrick DeMarco, you could eat $500,000 and save $1.8 million. None of them are big enough money to matter. So I don't know that finances are not going to be the reason that you cut any of those players. There's a chance that just based on performance, you could do that if you have somebody on the team that beats them out. They're all veterans. They're all contributors on special teams. But if we have a young guy who's talented, I think you could cut all of them and it wouldn't hurt anything. Those are the only ones from a financial standpoint. So again, bad news for anybody that wants Star Latulea to get cut. He's not. There's just no financial benefit to cutting him. Both Trent Murphy and Tyler Croft, we don't need to cut them. We have the money to keep them. We would need a replacement defensive end. We would need a replacement tight end. They're both paid more than they're probably worth, but not so much that we have to cut them. But they have a big enough cap savings number that it could matter. Then Lee Smith, Stephen Hauschka, Patrick DeMarco, none of them are making so much money that it's you need to cut them, but they're all, you know, older players that you could possibly replace cheaper and have a little bit of cap savings tied to them. So again, not anything that's going to really move the needle. There's a chance that we could take that cap number from 88 million closer to 100 million. There's no player that we're going to sign because we have 88 million or 100 million that we wouldn't sign because we had 88 million. We're going to be able to go out and go after just about any player we want. The next area we get into, before we get into the extensions, and I do want to talk about, I think the extensions are where the really exciting players are coming from, but we do have some good players coming up here that are unrestricted free agents. So in total, the Bills have 13 unrestricted free agents that are coming up. The 13 unrestricted free agents, a lot of names that you recognize: Jordan Phillips, Spencer Long, Lorenzo Alexander, Kevin Johnson, Shaq Lawson, Quentin Spain, Laadron Waddle, Frank Gore, Julian Stanford, Maurice Alexander, Kirk Coleman, Corey Legit, Sonoris Perry, and then we get into some of the restricted free agents and exclusive rights guys. Exclusive rights guys include people like Robert Foster, Duke Williams, Levi Wallace, Isaiah McKenzie, Vincent Taylor. That means that if the Bills want them back, they can come back. The team has the player can't go anywhere. They either play for the Bills or they don't go anywhere. Kroom is on that list as well, as a good call in the chat. So those are guys who can come back. They're not going to cost anything. The 13 unrestricted free agents is where you get into the compensation draft pick formula. I actually went into this assuming when I was doing this exercise that we were going to have a better chance of being able to get a comp pick. And I'm going to explain in a moment here why I don't think we're going to. So out of those guys, obviously there's a few easy names there. Nobody cares if, you know, no one's going to be beating themselves up to sign Maurice Alexander, Kirk Coleman, Sonoris Perry, people like that, Julian Stanford. I think that Lorenzo Alexander, to this point, is steady he's going to retire. I think that Frank Gore, now that he passed Barry Sanders, maybe he's got 1 year left. But I think I'm projecting that both Lorenzo Alexander and Frank Gore retire for this exercise. If they return, I actually think both of them would return to the Bills. I don't think they would necessarily go elsewhere. And so for that exercise, they're not going to impact the comp pick formula because either I project that they would come back to Buffalo or they would leave altogether. The next set is where you get into a couple names where I think there's guys who are going to come back. One is Spencer Long. Spencer Long stepped in really well when we saw Mitch Morse get injured. John Feliciano popped over to center. Spencer Long came in at guard. He's experienced. He's got good versatility. He's a valuable depth lineman. I think it's a little bit of a luxury that his team option is $4.2 million. But again, I would prefer to have that kind of veteran valuable depth there, even if we're paying a little bit more than what it's potentially worth. So I'm going to project that we exercise that option and keep him. You then get into a couple guys who are really starting to contribute, but I think you can get back at a little bit more reasonable deal. I think Laadron Waddle has been kept on injured reserve this whole time and did not get an injury settlement because they want him back. I assume they're going to sign him for the same deal they got him before, around $2 million. He's a valuable veteran swing tackle. I kind of wish we had him right now behind Cody Ford. So I'll count him at $2 million. I'm counting that they're going to give Corey Lugett the exact same deal they gave Jordan Phillips, the 1 year, $4.5 million. He's made a nice contribution. I think he was waiting to catch on with the team. I project they're going to bring him back at a reasonable deal and roughly what you pay a solid rotational defensive tackle. The next two, it's really going to depend on the number, but I'm going to project that we keep both Quentin Spain and Kevin Johnson, and I have them both at about $5 million. I think that Kevin Johnson is potentially taking over for Levi Wallace as a starting corner. I don't know if that's going to go to a full starter backup role, or maybe it's, you know, Aaron and I talked on the show after the Cowboys game that maybe it moves to Kevin Johnson 70% and Levi Wallace 30%, but I think that's going to be a little bit more here. Quentin Spain, I think, has done a great job. I think he's earned a contract. I'd be happy to give him, say, 3 years, $15 million over those 3 years, $5 million a year. Kevin Johnson, I'd probably do shorter term because of his injury history, but 2 years, $10 million, I'd be happy to do that. So I'm counting that we keep those five players. Those five players I have roughly at about $20 million to be able to, you know, re-sign that group of players. Then you get into a couple that are going to cost us the most money. Obviously, Jordan Phillips and Shaq Lawson. I like both Shaq Lawson and Jordan Phillips. I would love to be able to have them back at the right number. I have a feeling that both of them have played themselves a little bit out of our price range. Sacks are very flashy numbers. Owners will see that, especially a defensive tackle. I think Jordan Phillips might have played himself up into the double-digit million area, you know, 10, 11, 12. I heard some shows talking 13, 14 million, and that's just, it's just so much money. And I like Jordan Phillips a lot, but with Harrison Phillips coming back, with Corey Lugett contributing, Ed Oliver is a monster. We still have Star Latuale. I think next year you could function that way with a defensive tackle rotation, that you could have Ed Oliver and Corey Lugett, Star Latuale, Harrison Phillips, and have a four-man defensive tackle rotation that I think is legit. And I don't know that there's so much of a drop-off from Jordan Phillips to any of those four names I listed that it's worth giving Jordan Phillips $13 million or 3 years, $36 million, $39 million that I think it would take to re-sign him. If they can get him for a healthy number, I'll be happy. I'd like to keep him. But again, I'm going to get into some of the extensions coming up here and that who you'd be choosing not to re-sign. Those are some of the tough choices that we need to be able to take a look at and figure out where those things are going to fall. So right now I'm going to project that we don't keep Jordan Phillips because I think he's going to end up making more money than what we're willing to pay. Shaq Lawson's a little bit tougher. I don't know that Shaq Lawson's going to get a huge flashy contract number because he's not going to get double digit sacks. He's a good run defender. I don't know how many teams think that he was really motivated by the contract year and why did he have so-so performance in his first three years and then really played well in his contract year. Some teams get leery about that. If you could almost swap out Trent Murphy and give Trent Murphy's money to Shaq Lawson, I'd be open to that because that means you're getting him for $7, $8 million. If Shaq starts to get into double digits and $10 million plus, I just don't know that I'm going to go there for a guy like Shaq Lawson. I'm going to get into it here in a bit about some of the free agent targets. I'd rather throw a big chunk of money at a difference-making defensive end. My personal favorite is Yannick Ngakoue coming out of Jacksonville. But there's a number that I would give to Shaq Lawson. I don't know that I'd necessarily go into double digits for him. And I think that that's where it's going to fall, is right in between there. I see Joe in the chat here. What's going on, brother? So again, I'm projecting that both Jordan Phillips and Shaq Lawson are going to sign elsewhere. What comes up in the comp pick formula is you have to have more of your unrestricted free agents sign with other teams than what you sign onto the Bills. So if we don't sign Kevin Johnson or Quentin Spain or Corey Lugett or Laedron Waddle or Spencer Long and they signed elsewhere, and we lost Jordan Phillips, Shaq Lawson, Julian Stanford, you could get to the point where we could just sign one or two really high quality free agents and then net out an extra, say, fourth, fifth, sixth round pick. I don't think we'd get a third round pick because I think we'd spend big money on one of the free agents, and it would net out the Jordan Phillips contract, or we would keep him and you just wouldn't get the comp pick. So again, I actually think it's likely that we wouldn't get a comp pick and that we might sign two or three of outside free agents as it is, and then the rest of our money would be on signing there. So again, this is just an exercise going through there, but I'm going to project that we do those two cuts I talked about with Trent Murphy and Tyler Croft. That gets us $12 million, but that we spend $20 million re-signing five of our own players: Spencer Long, Kevin Johnson, Quentin Spain, Laid Rinwaddle, Corey Luja. That spends out $20 million there. That gets us back down to about $80 million in available cap space. The reason that's going to go quickly is we have four premier players that are coming up, and they're all under contract through 2020, but are coming up on extensions or for expiration after 2020. That's Jordan Poyer, that's Matt Milano, that's Deion Dawkins, that's Tre'Davious White, with the caveat that Tre'Davious White has a fifth-year option. But I'll talk about that when I get to him. All four of those are absolute pillar players that we must re-sign, all four of them. I think that that's the exact kind of thing that Bean and McDermott are trying to build, that if you come in here, you play well, you earn your money, we're going to take care of our own guys and bring those people back and build from within. I think they plan to re-sign each of them. They're all going to earn a healthy, healthy penny. We'll start with Jordan Poyer. Jordan Poyer is the only one who is a second contract player. He's going to be 30 when his contract expires, so he's in a position that he might not get the length of contract the other guys get. He's 28 now. He'll be 29 in 2020. He's looking at a big contract. You look at some of the guys that signed and got big money. I don't know that he has the exact resume that a some of the absolute highest end got, but I look at the contract Kevin Byard signed. I look at the contract some of the other guys got there. I think that Jordan Poyer is looking at about 3 years, $36 million. So at about $12 million on average, that's what that second tier of really elite safeties are getting. And I think that's going to be the ballpark of where he's at. So I'm going to project Jordan Poyer at 3 years, $36 million. The next one I'm looking at is Matt Milano. Right now, that contract market for the rangy sideline to sideline outside linebacker, it's right there in that $10 to $11 million range. He's coming off a rookie deal. He's younger. I think he gets about 4 years. So I'm projecting him at either 4 years, $40 million or 4 years, $44 million, right there, that $10 to $11 million a year range. And again, critical to be able to bring him back. Deion Dawkins, offensive tackles are expensive. It's going to sound like a big number. Deion's going to cost us probably $14 million a year. I don't think he's going to get the $18 million that Lane Johnson signed for today. Lane Johnson just signed for $18 million over 4 years, $72 million. I don't think Deion's going to get that, but I do project Deion to get 4 years, $56 million at $14 million a year. The name everybody's talking about here in the chat, obviously Trey White is our most valuable asset. Trey White has a couple things going for him here. One, we have the fifth year option on him. That's going to be roughly $11 to $11.5 million. We're obviously going to exercise that no matter what, but there's a lot of precedent now recently where what they've announced is the fifth year option plus an extension on top of that. So I'm projecting that they're going to give Trey the four-year extension, setting the new bar as the highest paid corner in the NFL at $16.5 million per year, 4 years. So they'll give him the 1 year, fifth year option at $11.5 million, then 4 more years at $66 million, at $16.5 million a year, and the highest paid corner in the league, for a total of 5 years and $78 million. So those four contracts, and I'm using average annual value, obviously with the cap gymnastics, you can be able to go in and be able to understand that you can play with those numbers. You can give a little bit more bonus money early. You can push some of that out. So some of this from a cap standpoint in 2020, you can manipulate. But being able to go that route, I think that it gives you a ballpark of where that's at. So again, I'm going to call Jordan Poyer at $12 million a year. I think he gets 3 years, $36 million. I'm going to put Matt Milano at $11 million and be able to go in for 4 years, $44 million. Deion Dawkins is at $14 million a year, so 4 years, $56 million. Trey White, I'm going to do the fifth-year option plus the four-year extension on top of that. So in 2020, he'd be $11.5 million, but into 2021 and beyond, he's going to be $16.5 million and one of the highest-paid corners in the NFL. You'll have him right up there with Marlon Humphrey and our friend in New Orleans, the Lattimore, who stole Trey's Defensive Rookie of the Year award. So, again, we're throwing around a lot of money here. So between the five players that we re-signed for $20 million, the four guys that we're extending, I have at $47.5 million. All of a sudden, that's $68.2 million. So when fans talk about, oh, man, we got $85, $90 million, that gets soaked up really quick. So doing the extensions, again, you can push some of that into the future. They'll use some of that cap space now to be able to give it out in bonuses, be able to front load some of that to be able to get that off of future years, especially with guys like Poyer, Milano, Dawkins, Trey White, that we're not worried about that money. We know they're going to be here long term. But being able to go through here, that soaks up a lot of that money. It also gives you a view that $68.2 million, all of a sudden, if you were to re-sign Jordan Phillips and Shaq Lawson, and they both cost, say, $13 million and $10 million, 13 and 10 is 23, 23 and 68, you're at $91 million. That's all of your money. So it's just funny how quick those things add up and that where you're looking at to be able to go through there. So as we get to that point, we're now at $68 million. We had a little bit of cushion from the cuts that we made. So Joe's helping me out here in the chat here. There's $32 million in cap space to go. We're going to count $10 million of that as the draft pick holds that are there. So you got to count that. It never nets out to that much because you end up releasing some bottom-end roster guys when you bring in the draft picks, and that nets out. Sometimes it's closer to $5 million, but just to be safe, we'll count $10 million, and we'll leave it there because Bean likes to keep a pool of money for injuries and things that are coming up there. I'm not going to go crazy on free agency because I don't think we're going to be huge spenders, but I did pick out a couple names at three positions that I think we could look at. I do think we see one, maybe two splurge signings. I don't think that we're going to see the kind of season offseason that we saw this year where we signed 20 unrestricted free agents. That's just crazy. But there's a handful of guys that I think are decent fits into what we're looking at. One, right now in my projection here, we cut Trent Murphy. We didn't re-sign Shaq Lawson. So we're short some defensive ends right now. One, I think we'll get there into the draft and where that comes. But I think that one of the areas that we'll have some spending here in the offseason is at pass rusher. My by far number one wish list is Yannick Ngakoue. Yannick Ngakoue is a perfect fit for what we're doing here. He's in a situation where Jacksonville would love to keep him, but they've already given out way too much money to way too many other people. They can't afford to be able to keep him, and that he's going to walk as a true unrestricted free agent, healthy, 25 years old, 4-3 defensive end, and could really be a contributor. I think I personally would throw $100 million at Yannick Ngakoue. I would go upwards of $110 million and give him $22 million a year. I would break the bank. He's the one player in free agency I would truly break the bank for. I would rather spend on him than Jadeveon Clowney, even though I like Clowney and think there's a debate that Clowney is a better player when healthy. And Ngakoue has a squeaky clean record, really hard worker, really dedicated to what he does, has been healthy and incredibly talented. I would be happy to spend up to $20 million in annual average salary on a guy like Yannick Ngakoue. Obviously, I'd still pursue a Jadeveon Clowney. I think you drop down into a next tier. There's a couple guys like Shaq Barrett and Robert Quinn. I'd consider going after them. I think they're both better pass rushers than what Shaq Lawson is, but maybe not as good a run defenders as Shaq is. So depending on what the team is looking for there, then you get into basically the Shaq lost in territory. Do you want to go after Ziggy Ansah? Do you want to do a reclamation project like Jason Pierre-Paul, Emmanuel Ogba, kind of a busted out draft pick who's done a little bit better after leaving Cleveland. So there are some high end pass rushers that are out there. The next position I think is possible is to add a piece at receiver. You know, obviously people know some of the higher end names. You'll see some veterans who are looking to catch on with a team, maybe like AJ Green, maybe like Emmanuel Sanders. A name I've seen come up in the chat quite a bit here is Nelson Agholor. I actually think that tier, there's two lesser known players that I really like who are unrestricted free agents. One, they're both speedsters. DeMarcus Robinson coming out of Kansas City and Trevor Davis out of Oakland are both really fast guys that I think we could possibly plug in into that same role that we're playing around here, competing with Robert Foster, you know, studying under John Brown, looking into to that area. So I would love to see a name like AJ Green. I think that's fun. I think Emmanuel Sanders is a veteran that could be able to play. I'd personally rather go more of the value route and look at a guy like DeMarcus Robinson. He'd be kind of my area to focus on. Prior to the last couple weeks, I thought that offensive tackle was going to be a bigger need and that we'd be talking about kicking in Cody Ford to guard. I'm now adjusting a little bit there in that, you know, Ford has had a couple of really good games and has looked good in what he's done, that we need to be more open for him to potentially be able to stay at tackle. So a couple names, if we somehow were to miss out on the extension for Deion Dawkins, or we need to move on from him, or that we did decide to move Cody Ford, Anthony Costanzo, Brian Bulaga, and Darrell Williams are all out there. They're solid tackles. They're all going to cost you upwards of $10 million or more. So I'm curious where that goes. But honestly, there's not a tremendous free agent market coming up this year. I think that as the chat's going through, I do think that we're going to see more being focused in the draft of where we're at there. So, again, I didn't want to go crazy into this, but I did look at a handful of names. Right now, the Bills would be picking 26th in each round. We have our own pick in rounds 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. We have an extra fifth. We have two extra sixths. So right now you're looking at the guys who are available in the late first. You have two pass rushers, one out of Penn State, Yader Gross-Matos. You have Clavon Chaisson coming out of LSU. Then you have the group of receivers, T. Higgins, Henry Ruggs, and I don't even know how to pronounce Chenault's first name. I've seen a couple of different people. Visca, I think LaVisca is his full name. I've heard him called Visca. I think that you could see them go after it. I know people in the chat have talked about, you know, we need our Julio Jones. I don't know that you're going to get a Julio Jones talent at the 26th overall. But I do think that those are some of the names that we could see in that area. So again, I'd like to see the first handful of picks be a defensive end, a wide receiver, an offensive tackle, and then I'll pick out some names here in the second round. A complement, if we do see Frank Gore retire, to bring in a powerful, explosive runner to complement with Devin Singletary. Maybe in the second or even in the third round, you could see a J.K. Dobbins, a Najee Harris. I don't know that we're going to see like a Travis Etienne or a Jonathan Taylor that might go earlier in the first round, but you might be able to see someone like Dobbins or Najee Harris or one of those guys later on in the second or third round. I wouldn't be upset to get a talent like Taylor or, you know, one of those kind of guys to be able to do it. But I think those are the positions. I'd like to see the first handful of positions in the draft. You're going to see some focus on pass rush, I think, is going to be a critical one. I think you will see an investment in wide receiver. I do think we'll bring in a running back, but, you know, nowadays you can wait till the third, fourth, fifth round to still get a talented running back. We got, you know, obviously Singletary in the third round. I think corner is looking at one because obviously we've seen a couple of flaws in Levi Wallace. You've also seen the injury history of Kevin Johnson, so you could see some investment there. And then later on, I think we have the need that if we're going to see guys like Julian Stanford or Maurice Alexander move on, we need to bring in a linebacker from a depth standpoint. Nowadays, we play the three-down linebacker maybe 20% of the time. So I think that we play between the big nickel, between our standard nickel, our three safety look. I think there's enough combination that you don't need a huge investment in a linebacker, but I'd like to see one of those fourth, fifth, sixth round picks, maybe at two linebackers to compete and a guy that can come in, restock some of the special teams as well as a contributor. I think you can also go out and sign a veteran guy who can play a similar role to Lorenzo Alexander on the linebacking side, maybe not the versatility that Zoe has, but we'll, you know, address that as it is. So again, went through a ton of stuff here tonight, but just thought it's really fun to be in a position as Bills fans. I'm going to ask you guys any last questions. I'm going to get ready to wrap up here, start shooting me some questions here, and I'll go through my rundown, and then I'll answer some ones that pop out here. Again, I'm projecting that I think the Bills are going to finish here with the fifth seed. I think they're going to open up with the winner of the AFC South and then hopefully win that game and go on to play the Patriots and make some noise here in the playoffs. I think the Bills are going to use a lot of their cap space this year on re-signing our own players. I think that we re-sign, you know, some of the guys who are coming up on contract with Spencer Long, Kevin Johnson, Quentin Spain, Laydron Waddle, Corey Lugett. I think that we'll then offer extensions very similar to how we did with Jerry Hughes. Like after that first run of free agency, sometime in later March, we'll see some of these extensions start coming through for Jordan Poyer, Matt Milano, Deion Dawkins, Trey White. We'll see some of those things coming out here and negotiations with them on extensions. And then I do think that we see, whether it's in free agency and or the draft, I think that obviously pass rush, wide receiver, some linebacker depth, some cornerback depth, and another complimentary running back are some of our top options to be able to go there. Chad was asking in here about signing or drafting a new kicker. I absolutely think that's in play. The fact that we're going in with that many extra picks, I think you could use a late round pick on a kicker. I think it would be competition. I'm actually always very hesitant on having a rookie kicker. You never know how they're going to approach things mentally, how they're going to be able to go in and handle the stress of kicking there. I would always prefer to sign a veteran that we know has the mental makeup to do that. But this year, you saw this is the worst year in NFL history in kicking accuracy. Multiple franchises are on their third and fourth and fifth kicker. So although Hauschka has not been acceptable, we actually probably have like the 10th or 12th worst kicking situation in the league. There's plenty of teams who would love to have Hauschka because they're on their fourth different kicker. So it's just been a weird year. I'd love to bring in some competition for him. I'm not sure that it's a replacement versus competition to push him. Prospect was asking about potential trades. I do obviously Bean has shown the willingness to make moves like that. I think it's really hard to project. There are some teams like the Rams, like the Jaguars, like the Vikings who are really hard up against the cap. If we have a chance to be able to take advantage of that and be able to really push, you know, being able to offer them some benefit here, I think you could be able to look at that. Cody asking about if we're going to beat the Ravens, and Daniel asking if we're going to spy Jackson. We'll talk about it more on the preview show on Wednesday. I do think that we have a chance to beat the Ravens, but they're 7-point favorites at Buffalo for a reason. They have put up 40 plus points three straight games, 30 plus points six straight games. They are the hottest team in the NFL right now, so picking that we're going to outright beat them would be an upset, but I do think that we can play with anybody, and that if you're hoping for that, I would encourage you to root for an awful lot of snow to slow down Lamar Jackson. And for Daniel's question, I don't think that we spy him exclusively. I think the key to beating Lamar Jackson is changing up your defensive looks and not going with the same thing over and over again. You have to keep him guessing. So some of those looks will be a spy. Some of those will be zone blitz. Some of those will be man. Some of those will be straight out zone. I think you have to vary it and be able to keep him guessing. I'll go through two more questions here. Dale was asking, is Gore going to keep playing or retire now that you were using Singletary more? He's only getting paid $2 million. It's a one-year deal. I'm projecting that he retires now that he passed Barry Sanders and is starting to really take a back seat for the first time in his career. It's possible he tries to go one more year, but I think that the writing's kind of on the wall to where that is. So we'll see where that ends up and how that goes. But right now I would project that that's where we see Frank Gore, is that this is his last run. We get a playoff run here. He passed Barry Sanders for third all time. And then obviously is in a great position. And then Jimbit has the question that I love. Do you think Brady retires after this year and Buffalo takes the division next year? I don't think Brady retires. I think he's got one more year in him. I think that he's showing some real significant gaps in his arm strength, and that's starting to come. When we've seen that in the past with guys like Peyton Manning, it goes quick. So when it starts to drop off and go downhill, it really drops off a cliff. And I think there's a chance that we could see that with Brady. And then next year, maybe it's the ugly Peyton Manning final year, and that not only would Brady not retire, but we can take the division while he's still playing to get the satisfaction of beating him and not simply taking it after he retires, which is where my real dream comes from, is that we get the satisfaction of taking it directly out of his hands and then letting him ride off into the sunset, not going out on the high and going out watching the Bills being the better team in the division. So thank you guys for the awesome chat here tonight. You guys were fantastic. There's a ton more questions. I wish I could get to everything here, but going for this long solo is enough on my throat to be able to handle it here. So make sure you guys come out, check out what's going on, everything we got at cover1.net. Become a premium subscriber, jump in the Slack channel. It's awesome. We have a great crowd. Tons of the guys are in here in the chat here with us tonight. I thought this was a great opportunity to be able to kind of step back and talk about some of the other things that are going on and just some things looking forward that we haven't had a chance to do in a long time. So I thought this was a lot of fun. You guys were great in the chat here. Really appreciate it. Enjoy everything that we got going on. Check out the preview show that we'll have up on Wednesday, and then we'll talk to you guys afterwards. But I appreciate everything you guys are doing. You guys have been listening to Cover One Buffalo, and we are out.